Good evening, George Orwell. Perhaps we should start with you telling us a little about yourself.
I like English cookery, English beer, French red wine, Spanish white wine, Indian tea, strong tobacco, coal fire, candlelight, and comfortable chairs.
Go on.
I dislike big towns, noise, the motor car, the radio, tinned food, and central heating.
Interestingly...
And modern furniture.
Quite.
Famous for writing 1984 and inventing Big Brother, George Orwell witnessed and reported on some of the defining moments of the 20th century. But there are no moving pictures of Orwell, nor are there any recordings of his voice. He did leave a vast written legacy, containing insights on everything from diet to revolution. It's this we used to create his life in pictures. The pictures are invented, but every statement Orwell utters is his own. In an early documentary, Orwell is an imperial policeman. In a film essay, he's a kitchen hand.
Roughly speaking, the more one is obliged to pay for food, the more sweat and spittle one is obliged to eat with it.
In Newsreel, he's glimpsed as a freedom fighter.
The perfect cup of tea. My own rules, every one of which I regard as golden.
And war reporter.
And enormous piles of rubble, out of which iron girders thrust themselves like sticks of rhubarb.
Towards the end of his career, he penned the confessional essay, Why I Write.
All writers are vain, selfish, and lazy. And at the bottom of their motives, there lies a mystery.
And so you have no control over what you write.
Writing a book is a horrible, exhausting struggle, like a long bout with some painful illness. One would never undertake such a thing if one were not driven by some demon one can neither resist nor fully comprehend.
1984, with its thought police, Room 101 and Big Brother, has given us a language with which we can defy oppression. What demon drove you to dream up 1984?
I do not think one can assess a writer's motives without knowing something of his early development. His subject matter will be determined by the age in which he lives. But before he ever begins to write, he will have acquired an emotional attitude from which he will never completely escape.
George Orwell's real name was Eric Blair. He was born on the 25th of June, 1903, into what he labelled the lower upper middle class. This mock Tudor villa in the Thames Valley was the Blair family home. He was only 8 when he was sent away to boarding school.
It is not easy for me to think about my school days without seeming to breathe a whiff of something cold and evil smelling.
Such were the joys when we all girls and boys.
Such were the joys was an autobiographical essay on Blair's school days. Considered libelous, it wasn't published in his lifetime. But as this expressionist film adaptation shows, it is crucial to understanding his character.
Soon after I arrived, I began to wet the bed, a disgusting crime. Night after night, I prayed with a fervor never previously attained in my prayers. Please, God, do not let me wet the bed. Oh, please, God, do not let me wet the bed. But it made remarkably little difference. The grim, statuesque matron, Daphne by name, arrived in the dormitory especially to inspect my bed. She pulled back the sheets, then drew herself up, and the dreaded words seemed to come rolling out of her like a peal of thunder. Report yourself to the headmaster after breakfast. He knew, of course, why I had been sent to him, and had already taken a bone-handled riding crop out of the cupboard. He read me a short but pompous lecture, seized me by the scruff of the neck, and began to beat me. I knew that bedwetting was A, wicked, and B, outside my control. It was possible, therefore, for me to commit a sin without wanting to commit it. This was the great abiding lesson of my boyhood, that I was in a world where it was not possible for me to be good.
Eric Blair was instinctively rebellious and independent. But to become the English language's fiercest critic of tyranny and privilege, he would have to completely reinvent himself.
Later, I was educated at Eton. To me, in my boyhood, to children of nearly all families like mine, common people seemed almost subhuman. I was an odious little snob. But I was both a snob and a revolutionary.
The writer Cyril Connolly was at Eton with Blair. He talked about those days to the television presenter Malcolm Muggeridge.
If someone had said to you in those days, what do you think of that boy Blair, what would you have answered?
He was always laughing and arguing and barracking and quibbling with people and heckling.
Yeah.
And he seemed, like Socrates, to be constantly questioning everybody and everything they did or said, and always with this wheezy laughter. You think that, but my God, I don't think you'd think it in 10 years' time, or if you hadn't got this or that, etc. He was a debunker before the word existed.
After Eton, Blair and Connolly lost touch. Connolly, like most bright boys of his class, went to university. Blair went in search of tyranny, to which he was drawn like a moth to a flame. This silent movie promoted Burma's contribution to Britain's Indian Empire. Made in the mid-20s, it was one of the earliest observational documentaries. It seems that the local superintendent was unaware cameras were watching him.
Shortly after I left school, I wasn't quite 20 years old then, I went to Burma and joined the Indian Imperial Police. Seen from the outside, the British rule in India appears benevolent, even necessary. But the truth is that no modern man, in his heart of hearts, believes it is right to invade a foreign country and hold the population down by force. But I was in the police, which is to say I was part of the machinery of despotism. I watched a man hanged once. It was a sodden morning of the rains. A sickly light was slanting over the high wall into the jail yard. He was a puny wisp of a man with a thick, sprouting moustache. He walked clumsily with his bound arms, but quite steadily, and once, in spite of the men who gripped him by each shoulder, he stepped slightly aside to avoid a puddle on the path. It is curious, but till that moment I had never realized what it means to destroy a healthy, conscious man. When I saw the prisoner step aside to avoid the puddle, I saw the mystery, the unspeakable wrongness of cutting a life short when it is in full tide. This man was not dying. He was alive, just as we were alive. He and we were a party of men walking together, seeing, hearing, feeling, understanding the same world, and in 2 minutes, one of us would be gone. One mind less, one world less. It seemed to me worse than 1,000 murders. I could not go on any longer serving an imperialism which I had come to regard as very largely a racket.
When I came home on leave in 1927, I was already determined to throw up my job. For 5 years, I was part of an oppressive system, and it had left me with a bad conscience.
From a very early age, perhaps the age of 5 or 6, I knew that when I grew up I should be a writer. Between the ages of about 17 and 24, in Burma, I tried to abandon this idea, but I did so in the consciousness that I was outraging my true nature, and that sooner or later I would have to settle down and write books.
But at this stage you were still Eric Blair, and the brand of literature that you first attempted was the polar opposite of 1984.
At that time, I wanted to write enormous naturalistic novels with unhappy endings, full of detailed descriptions and arresting similes, mm-hmm. and also full of purple passages.
By the winter of 1928, after 6 months of writing, Blair hadn't sold so much as a sentence. Holed up in a miserably cold studio here in West London, he was struggling with both his art and a physical handicap. Since childhood, he had suffered from frequent chest infections. By his mid-20s, that had developed into a chronic illness, possibly TB. In the 20s, fear of being quarantined kept many infected people from getting tested for TB.
Tuberculosis killed thousands of Britons last year.
From the few that did come forward, some were shanghaied into public information films that encouraged others to do likewise.
Take this young man. Perhaps he's scrimped on heating coal, or he's been short of food lately. Anyway, an old cough has just got worse. Probably smoking too much, he would have joked to his mates. He was. Now let's have a look at his X-ray. You see that patch on the lung? That's evidence of tuberculosis.
You'll have to go into hospital for treatment. I'll arrange that for you. It's what you must do when you come out that's so important. First, you must get some light open-air job. Then you'll have to have a special diet. I'm sorry to have upset you, I can only do my job.
Throughout his life, he ignored doctors' orders, especially if they got in the way of his writing.
During 1928-29, I lived in Paris, writing a novel which no one would publish and which I afterwards destroyed. But at that time, failure seemed to be the only virtue. When my money ran out, I worked for a time as a dishwasher in an hotel. I lived mostly from hand to mouth and went hungry on several occasions. I was very happy. Here I was at the lowest of the low, at the bedrock of the Western world.
Returning to London, Blair sank deeper into the underclass.
I lived for months among the poor and half-criminal elements who inhabit the worst parts of the poorest quarters, begging and stealing. I associated with them through lack of money, but later their way of life interested me for its own sake.
By his late 20s, he was writing and selling articles about life in the gutter. Ironically, this correspondent of the dispossessed was then living in genteel comfort with his parents in Southwold, a seaside resort in Suffolk.
He gave up his job, which wasn't very well thought of in those days, you know. One's parents put one in something. One was expected to stay, but he came home.
Disappointed.
Disappointed more than anything.
He tried to exploit his failure by writing a book about being a down and out. Working in secret, he spent 2 years on it.
I remember him very well. Very tall and lanky. He had an awfully nice face, you know.
But well, nothing. Yes, a gentle, kind yes, face.
Not good looking at all.
And you remember that his sleeves were always up here, didn't
yes,
you?
Yes, and he'd grown out of his bony sleeves. Wrists, and yes, as though he'd grown out of his clothes, but he couldn't have looked like that at Eton.
No, he had to conform there. Well, he looked rather like a tramp always.
Behind the clouds, there's crowds and crowds of sunbeams shining for you.
Blair's finished manuscript was sent to the left-wing publisher Gollancz. They described it as utterly disgusting, but socially important, and they agreed to put it out. Suddenly concerned for his parents' reputations, Blair devised a pseudonym. His new first name came from the king, his second from a local river.
Mr. George Orwell. We at Gollancz have made this short film to introduce his first book, Down and Out in Paris and London. It's a record of his odyssey through the lawless underclass created by the unprecedented unemployment of many millions of working men.
I was conscious of an immense weight of guilt I had to expiate. I felt I had got to escape from every form of man's dominion over man. The social outcasts, tramps, beggars, criminals, prostitutes. Once I had been among them and been accepted by them, I should have touched bottom. Part of my guilt would drop away. I've worn bad enough things before, but nothing at all like these. They have, how can one express it, a gracelessness, a patina of antique filth. There is a feeling that is a great consolation in poverty. You have talked so often of going to the dogs, and, well, here are the dogs, and you've reached them, and you can stand it. It is a feeling of relief, almost of pleasure, at knowing yourself at last, genuinely down and out. Reading Down and Out in Paris and London will change your life, because writing it has changed Mr. Orwell. I will never again think all tramps are drunken scoundrels, nor expect a beggar to be grateful when I give him a penny, nor be surprised when men out of work lack energy, nor refuse a handbill, nor enjoy a meal in a smart restaurant. That is a beginning.
One critic has claimed that you cannot blow your nose without moralising on conditions in the handkerchief industry. But were you such a political firebrand when George Orwell was invented in 1933?
I spent 5 years in an unsuitable profession, the Indian Imperial Police in Burma. I then underwent poverty and a sense of failure. This increased my natural hatred of authority. But these experiences were not enough to give me an accurate political orientation.
His literary income remained slight. But in 1934, Orwell left his parents and rented a room in Hampstead, North London. This was then an enclave of intellectuals with fashionably left views.
I knew that I had a facility with words and a power of facing unpleasant facts. Unfortunately, you do not solve the class problem by making friends with tramps. In the highbrow world, you get on, if you get on at all, by going to cocktail parties and kissing bums.
One of Orwell's friends whilst he was in Hampstead was the anthropologist Geoffrey Gora.
I would have said he was an unhappy man. He was fairly well convinced that nobody would like him. Which made him prickly.
The middle-class, bearded fruit juice drinkers are all for a classless society, so long as they see the proletariat through the wrong end of the telescope. Force them into any real contact with a proletarian, and they're capable of swinging back into the most ordinary snobbishness.
Even so, it was at a party in this house that Orwell met Oxford graduate and trainee psychologist Eileen O'Shaughnessy. She had, according to admirers, eyes that danced.
She was very pretty, very intelligent, very philosophical. She was very much interested in people. She was very much interested in everything. She was always thinking. I mean, her mind was working on those sort of things all the time.
Within days of meeting Eileen, Orwell proposed. And though she knew very little about him, she didn't say no. Lettice Cooper was one of the few friends to whom Eileen spoke about her feelings for Orwell.
She thought he was a very good writer, but I wouldn't say she took him seriously. She was very much amused often at things he said and did. He was very often thinking about something else. I mean, he was in a kind of world of his own half the time. But I think he loved her.
But Orwell's writing barely earned enough for him to scrape along. There wasn't enough for two. To cover the rent, he was working part-time in a bookshop, a job he was later invited to celebrate. Bookshop memories wasn't what anyone expected.
In a town like London, there are always plenty of not quite certifiable lunatics walking the streets, and they tend to gravitate towards bookshops. They would come in and demand some rare and expensive book, would make us promise over and over again to keep it for them, and then would vanish, never to return. Many of them, of course, were unmistakable paranoiacs. There was a time when I really did love books, loved the sight and smell and feel of them. But as soon as I went to work in the bookshop, I stopped buying books. Seen in the mass, 5 or 10,000 at a time, books were boring and even slightly sickening.
Even the inanimate world was against him. He was awfully likely to knock things off tables, to trip over things. I mean, he was a gangling, physically badly coordinated young man.
After just over a year there, Orwell resigned from the bookshop.
To suppress my snobbishness, I have got to alter myself so completely that at the end I should hardly be recognisable as the same person.
And he needed money to marry Eileen.
I couldn't afford a ring, except perhaps a Woolworths one.
Gollancz offered him a potentially lucrative assignment to travel into industrial Britain and report on the distress of the working class. Orwell recorded his trip north in the road to Wigan Pier. A key set piece in the road to Wigan Pier is Orwell's first trip down a mine.
Here am I, a typical member of the middle class. It's easy for me to say I want to get rid of class distinctions, but nearly everything I think and do is the result of class distinctions. It's no use my clapping a proletarian on the back and telling him he's as good a man as I am. If I want real contact, I have to make an effort, for which, very likely, I'm unprepared. I am handicapped by being exceptionally tall. You've got to not only bend double, but also keep your head up all the while so as to see the beams and girders and dodge them as they come. You have, therefore, a constant crick in the neck, but this is as nothing compared to the pain in your knees and thighs. After half a mile, it becomes, I'm not exaggerating, unbearable agony. One begins to wonder whether one will ever get to the end, and still more, how on earth one's going to get back.
We travel further in, and the further in we travel, the lower the roof, and I would think he'd to travel best part of 3/4 mile. Bent absolutely double. The working face was, I think, 26 inches. And by the time we landed there, Orwell was, unquestionably, he was exhausted. He was flattered.
It's only when you see the miners down the mine and naked you realise what splendid men they are. Most of them are small, but nearly all of them have the most noble bodies, wide shoulders tapering to slender, supple waists, small, pronounced buttocks, and sinewy thighs, with not an ounce of wasted flesh anywhere. All of us really owe the comparative decency of our lives to poor drudges underground, blackened to the eyes, with their throats full of coal dust, driving their shovels forward with arms and belly muscles of steel. The miner's job would be as much beyond my power as it would be to perform on a flying trapeze or to win the Grand National. The work would kill me in a few weeks.
The day after going down the mine, Orwell staggered west to Liverpool to visit a friend, Mary Dyna.
He was a strange figure. No overcoat, no hat, no bag, and a threadbare coat, standing there and shivering. He was actually shivering from head to foot. Well, he collapsed. Well, not quite collapsed, but as near as made no matter. So my husband and I, we got him to bed as quickly as we could, and he was really very ill.
But within days, Orwell was back on his feet. His mission now carried him into the industrial slums of South Yorkshire.
Sheffield, I suppose. could justly claim to be the ugliest city in the old world. Its inhabitants, who want it to be preeminent in everything, very likely do make that claim for it.
As you walk through the slums, you lose yourself in labyrinths of brick houses festering in planless chaos. The interiors of the houses are all the same. All have an almost exactly similar living room, 10 or 15 feet square.
The average unemployed family lives on an income of about 30 shillings a week, of which at least a quarter goes in rent. It is worth considering in some detail how the remaining money is spent.
The basis of their diet is white bread and margarine, corned beef, sugared tea and potatoes. An appalling diet. The results of this are visible in a physical degeneracy. In Sheffield, you have the feeling of walking among a population of troglodytes.
The question of the unemployed and all the distressed areas was terribly well portrayed, and you felt that really he'd done all in his power to get himself into this situation in order to be able to. You really felt that he'd become one of them as far as is possible for anybody with such a different background to get into.
This is what industrialism has done for us. Columbus sailed the Atlantic, the first steam engines tottered into motion, the British squares stood firm under the French guns at Waterloo, the one-eyed scoundrels of the 19th century praised God and filled their pockets, and this is where it has all led.
To labyrinthine slums and dark back kitchens with sickly aging people creeping round and round them like black beetles.
It is a kind of duty to see and smell such places now and again, especially smell them, lest you should forget that they exist. At the back of one of the houses, a young woman was kneeling on the stones, poking a stick up the leaden waste pipe which ran from the sink inside and which I suppose was blocked. I had time to see everything about her, her sacking apron, her clumsy clogs, her arms reddened by the cold. She looked up and I was almost near enough to catch her eye. She had a round, pale face, the usual exhausted face of the slum girl who is 25 and looks 40 thanks to miscarriages and drudgery. And it wore, for the second in which I saw it, the most desolate, hopeless expression I've ever seen. We are mistaken when we say it isn't the same for them as it would be for us. For what I saw in her face was not the ignorant suffering of an animal. She knew well enough what was happening to her, understood as well as I did how dreadful a destiny it was to be kneeling there in the bitter cold on the slimy stones of a slum backyard, poking a stick up a foul drainpipe.
In The Road to Wigan Pier, you venerate the working class. For an old Etonian like yourself, that is a political act.
Using the word political in the widest possible sense, desire to push the world in a certain direction, to alter other people's idea of the kind of society they should strive after.
So you were, by your early 30s, a political writer?
No book is completely free of political bias.
There was such an extraordinary change, both in his writing and in a way also in his attitude after he'd been to the North. I mean, it's almost as if there'd been a kind of fire smouldering in him all his life, which suddenly sort of broke into flame.
The road to Wigan Pier was an immediate success.
At the end of 1935, I was able to live on what I earned by writing and moved into the country, in Wallington, in Hertfordshire.
Gypsy came round to the door with a little aspidester in a pot.
He even felt able to provide for Eileen.
Eric Arthur Blair, Bachelor of this parish, Eileen Maud O'Shenley, spinster, parish of Greenwich. She walked up the road and he walked up the bridleway or the footpath and leapt over the wall and joined her in the porch.
When Orwell and Eileen married, she was 31. He was almost 33.
He was a lonely man until he met Eileen, a very lonely man. I think the only year that I ever knew him really happy was that first year with Eileen.
To reduce their outgoings, the couple kept a vegetable patch, a chicken run, and even a goat called Muriel.
When Ma was newly wed, a gypsy came round to the door with a little aspidester in a pot. Said he, give me a pair of trousers, missus, and it's yours. So Ma gave him father's trousers on the spot. It's years ago since mother gave away Pa's only pair, and Pa, father's never worked since, but dear mother doesn't care. With a lovely
Muriel, milking
the old
hint.
Art pot, old art pot.
Get her up against the wall. If she gives trouble, you can steady her with your shoulder. And, having greased your fingers, massage the udder a little and then grip the nearest teat pretty firmly at the root. If you are gripping at the right place, you will feel it fill with milk and thicken in your hand. Then, still gripping pretty hard, if you are hurting her, she will soon let you know, draw the hand down the teat, being careful not to relax the pressure till you reach the end. When no more milk comes out of this teat, go on to the other. The whole operation should take about 5 minutes.
But that Christmas, Muriel lost her milker. Once again, he had gone off in search of tyranny.
The driving force behind fascism is the belief in human inequality. Hitler had walked into power and proceeded to massacre political opponents of all shades. Mussolini had bombed Abyssinia, while 53 nations made pious noises off. But when Franco tried to impose fascism, the Spanish people, against all expectation, had risen against him. It seemed possible that it was the turning of the tide.
By the winter of 1936, Spain's struggle against fascism had escalated into civil war.
Pictures of the Spanish Civil War tell a story of graphic violence. As the fascist horde encircles it, the beautiful and ancient city of Barcelona fills with freedom fighters from around the world. Our roving reporter spoke to one heroic Briton.
I have come to Spain to fight fascism. After all, there are not such a terrific lot of fascists in the world, so if we each shoot one of them...
Under the glorious banner of the flag.
When Orwell arrived in Barcelona just before New Year, 37, the civil war there had taken an unexpected turn. The trade unions, who had formed militias to defeat the fascists, had by now gone a step further. A revolution had taken place.
Young and old,
farmers, workers, teachers.
It was the first time I'd ever been in a town where the working class were in the saddle.
It was the aspect of the crowds that was the queerest thing. There were no well-dressed people at all. It was a town where the wealthy class practically ceased to exist.
In human history.
This really was a workers' state.
A military machine and an improvised army of masses.
I joined the militia almost immediately because at that time and in that atmosphere it seemed the only conceivable thing to do. If you had asked me what I was fighting for, I should have answered, common decency.
Days after arriving in Spain, Corporal Orwell was marched into the mountains west of Barcelona. This was where the workers' revolution planned to stop fascism in its tracks. For the enlightenment of future generations, documentary cameras would record the historic battles.
Nothing happened. Nothing ever happened. In nearly 3 weeks, I had fired just 3 shots at the enemy. They say it takes 1,000 bullets to kill a man. But at this rate, it would take 20 years before I killed my first fascist.
All true tea lovers like their tea strong. 6 heaped teaspoons should be about right. Now, no strainers or bags to imprison the tea. Actually, one can swallow tea leaves in considerable quantities without any ill effect. One should pour the tea into the cup first. This is one of the most controversial points of all. But I maintain that by putting the tea in first, one can more precisely regulate the amount of milk that goes in, whereas you are liable to put too much milk in if you do it the other way around. Lastly, tea should always be drunk without sugar. It would be equally reasonable to put in pepper or salt.
After 4 months at the front, Orwell was granted leave to visit Barcelona. Eileen had also made it to Spain and was waiting for him there.
Getting back to Barcelona, I discovered that a deep change had come over the town. The revolutionary atmosphere had vanished. Once again, it was an ordinary city with no outward signs of working-class predominance. The normal division of the city into rich and poor, upper and lower class, was reasserting itself.
And the people responsible? The communists.
Although officially the militia's allies, Spain's Communist Party was deeply alarmed by the rise of democratic freedom in Barcelona's workers' state. In May 37, as Orwell met up with Eileen, the city was bracing itself for a communist-led counter-revolution.
I heard some rifle shots behind me. I turned around and saw some youths with rifles in their hands and red and black handkerchiefs round their throats. I thought instantly, it started.
The next 3 days and nights I spent continuously on the roof of a cinema.
I was in no danger. I suffered nothing worse than hunger and boredom.
The official death toll during the May riots was 400. When it was over, the communists controlled Barcelona. Militiamen were ordered to quit the city or become good communists.
Well, I could not join any communist-controlled unit. It might mean being used against the Spanish working class. One could not tell when this kind of thing would break out again, and if I was to use my rifle at all in such an affair, I would use it on the side of the working class, not against them.
Orwell returned to his militia unit at the front. At dawn, on the 20th of May, Orwell relieved his American colleague Harry Milton from guard duty.
It was a beautiful sunrise. He stuck his head over the parapet, which was very dangerous. Then I heard a shot, and he toppled over. I put his head in my arms, and when I put my hand under his neck, there was a puddle of blood. He was shot through the neck.
The bullet passed right through, just missing a major artery. Weakened by TB, Orwell was very vulnerable to severe trauma. A year later, he was still recuperating in a British sanatorium.
Oh, the whole experience of being hit by a bullet is very interesting. In fact, I think it's worth describing in some detail. Roughly speaking, it is the sensation of being at the center of an explosion. A loud bang, and then a blinding flash of light all around me, and I felt a tremendous shock. No pain, just a violent shock, such as you get from an electric terminal. With it, a sense of being stricken and shriveled up to nothing. There must have been about 2 minutes during which I assumed I was killed. Which was interesting. My first thought, conventionally enough, was for my wife. My second thought was a violent resentment at having to leave this world, which, when all is said and done, suits me so well. The stupid mischance of it infuriated me. The meaninglessness of it.
A month after being shot, Orwell was walking wounded, back in Barcelona, with discharge papers in his pocket. But the city had become dangerous for militiamen. The communists, following the orders of their Soviet backers, demanded absolute allegiance. It was subversive even to think ill of the party. Orwell was getting his first taste of totalitarianism. It was all the more shocking because it came from former allies on the left.
For some time, a reign of terror was in progress. Police spies were everywhere. The jails were still crammed with prisoners left over from the May fighting, and others were disappearing into jail by ones and twos. So far as one could discover, no one was ever tried or even charged. You were simply flung into jail and kept there, usually incommunicado. Practically everyone we knew was in jail by this time.
Eileen was wonderful. In fact, actually seemed to enjoy it. It was a queer business. We started off by being heroic defenders of democracy and ended up slipping over the border with the police panting at our heels. We were very lucky to get out of Spain alive.
The Spanish War turned the scale, and thereafter I knew where I stood. Every line of serious work that I've written since 1936 has been written, directly or indirectly, against totalitarianism. In a more peaceful age, I might have written ornate or merely descriptive books. As it is, I've been forced into becoming a sort of pamphleteer.
His campaign was against every form of totalitarianism. But Orwell was not fully fit again until 1939. By then, Franco had won the Spanish Civil War, and Nazi Germany was threatening much of Europe. It was a time for art to be anti-fascist. Orwell contributed to this movement with an articulate celebration of English popular culture.
I believe in England. It is a living contradiction of all the infallible dogmas of fascism. A minor English trait, which is extremely well marked, though not often commented on, is a love of flowers. It is found in people who have no aesthetic feelings. What it does link up with, however, is another English characteristic, which is so much a part of us that we barely notice it. And that is the addiction to hobbies and spare time occupations. privateness of English life. We are a nation of flower lovers, but also a nation of stamp collectors, pigeon fanciers, amateur carpenters, coupon snippers, darts players, crossword puzzle fans. All the culture that is most truly native centres around things which, even when they are communal, are not official. The pub, the football match, the back garden, the fireside, and the nice cup of tea. The liberty of the individual is still believed in. The totalitarian idea that there is no such thing as law, there is only power, has never taken root. In England, such concepts as justice, liberty, and objective truth are still believed in. They may be illusions, but they are very powerful illusions.
In September 1939, Britain declared war on Nazi Germany. To improve understanding of the conflict, Orwell volunteered for a public debate.
To speak against the war, we have here tonight the writer and critic Derek Savage, as well as the poet and sexologist Alex Comfort. Making the case against them is George Orwell.
Pacifism is objectively pro-fascist. This is elementary common sense. If you hamper the war effort of one side, you automatically help that of the other. In practice, he who is not with me is against me.
Fascism is not a force confined to any one nation. We're just as likely to find it here as anywhere else. The characteristic markings of fascism are curtailment of individual liberties, the abolition of private life and private values. These are all tendencies of present-day Britain. The pacifist is opposed to all of these and might therefore be called the only genuine anti-fascist.
Ha! If Mr. Savage and others imagine that one can somehow overcome the German army by lying on one's back, let them continue to imagine that, but let them also wonder occasionally if this is not an illusion due to security, too much money, and a simple ignorance of the way things actually happen.
There are innumerable reasons why war should be opposed. The chief reason is the diabolical nature of modern warfare.
The idea...
Repercussions.
The idea that one can somehow remain aloof from and superior to the struggle while living on food that British sailors have had to risk their lives to bring us is a bourgeois illusion based on security and money.
Mr. Orwell is intellectual hunting again. He's made the discovery that almost every writer under the age of 30 in this country already has their feet on the slippery slope towards fascism. Whilst we all know Mr. Orwell to be a preacher of the doctrine of physical courage as an asset to the left-wing intellectual.
Despotic governments can stand moral force till the cows come home. What they fear is physical force.
When war broke out, I was rejected by the army because of my lungs. My health is wretched, but it's never prevented me from doing anything that I wanted to, except fight in the war.
Blamed the German victories at the start of the war on Britain's ruling class. He believed no aristocrat would defeat Hitler, because even in Britain they were too remote to unite and energize ordinary people.
Hello. It is almost certain that England will be invaded during the next few days or weeks, and I want to talk to you about how we at home can most effectively respond to this threat. Our slogan should be, arm the people.
When the government created a civil defence force, the Home Guard. Within 24 hours, 250,000 men enlisted.
You are a new corps, a corps with its traditions to make. But you have already got your motto, and your motto is, kill the Boche.
Sergeant Orwell was keen as mustard. Eileen told a friend that she could bear the machine gun under their bed, but that the grenades on the mantelpiece were too much.
Firearms. Everybody should have one and know how to use and clean it. It might just save your life, but more importantly, there's nothing that demoralizes an invading soldier more than being shot at. Hand grenades. These will be absolutely necessary if enemy parachutists with machine guns manage to establish themselves in our large towns. Which brings me to street fighting. Next time you're outdoors, take a look at an ordinary street. Note the many examples of cover available: dustbins, pillar boxes, street lamps, etc. Also, take a look at houses. Imagine attacking one. What would be the best way in? Remember, it's almost always best to go in from the roof. Imagine the demoralizing effect of attack from above. And never forget, it's always easier to throw a bomb downstairs than up.
As well as practical advice, Orwell outlined a political role for the Home Guard.
A village hall on a quiet summer evening. But there seems to be something doing.
He proposed that the Dad's army act as the militia had done in the Spanish Civil War.
It is only by revolution that the native genius of the English people can be set free. We have got to fight against privilege, against the notion that a half-witted public schoolboy is better for command than an intelligent mechanic. We have got to break the grip of the moneyed class as a whole. There will be a bitter political struggle. At some point or other, it may be necessary to use violence. We shall have to fight against bribery, ignorance, snobbery. The bankers and larger businessmen, the landowners and dividend drawers, the officials with their prehensile bottoms will obstruct for all they are worth. But the chances are the will of the majority will prevail. We are in a strange period of history in which a patriot has to be a revolutionary. And a revolutionary has to be a patriot.
It was your idea.
I find him a very exciting person to meet, who said what I would like to have said.
Idealistic and young, David Astor became a loyal supporter of Orwell.
He really saw things in a way that I felt I instinctively reacted to as being right. It was his sort of counterpoint to Churchill's speeches. It was sort of his reason why he wanted to fight the war and why he liked Britain and what he thought its future should be.
Displaying his instinct for being at the heart of great events, Orwell and Eileen moved into London, just in time for the Blitz.
During the war, he said to me how much he hated London, but he said, of course, you can't leave when people are being bombed to bits all around you.
Tis you, I must go, and I must
die. The novelist Julian Simmons became one of Orwell's closest friends during the war.
There was something both very friendly about Orwell when you met him, but also something very remote. He was a kind of permanent outsider, and his behaviour was sometimes absurd in what I found an endearing way. Like at our lunches, there would always be on the menu perhaps some really quite good bit of food, like, say, liver and bacon. Orwell would never have that. What he would go for would be the victory pie, which was practically uneatable, and he would eat it quite zestfully and say with, in a rather happy way, you won't get anything better than this nowadays.
King and Queen in London continue the inspection of the areas which have suffered in the nightly bombing of the capital.
What he called the We're All In It Together mood of 1940 forced Orwell to change his attitude to his compatriots.
I fell into the trap of assuming that the war and the revolution are inseparable. Now, I have to admit that I was grossly wrong in my analysis of the situation. It would be absurd to imagine that Britain is on the brink of revolution.
Churchill boasted that the motto of the British people was business as usual. Orwell was both frustrated and charmed by this lack of reaction. He was concerned about the future.
Life goes on much the same. In the face of terrifying dangers and golden political opportunities, people just keep on keeping on, in a sort of twilight sleep in which they are conscious of nothing but the daily round of work, family life, darts at the pub, exercising the dog, bringing home the supper, beer, etc., etc. And the Home Guard. It is so very typical of Britain that this vast organisation has had absolutely no conscious political development at all. It has not developed into the People's Army, like the Spanish militias. It is held together by no political creed, but by inarticulate patriotism. The fact that more than 2 million men have rifles in their bedrooms, and the authorities contemplate this without dismay, is the sign of a stability unequalled by any other country in the world.
In 41, Orwell, having abandoned hope of revolution, even put aside his quest for truth. He joined the Ministry of Information's propaganda unit, the BBC. He would produce and present a radio show for listeners in India. His BBC office was room 101.
He certainly thought that the propaganda machines are propaganda machines, and he didn't like being part of one. On the other hand, he accepted that a war required all this apparatus.
London calling at the beginning of tonight's broadcast in the BBC's Eastern Service.
In the Far East, the governor of Hong Kong states that heavy fighting is in progress.
In Britain, the fat ration has been cut down to 8 ounces a week. The ordinary people who have to put up with these restrictions do not grumble.
The position is stabilised on any of the fronts. And in the Far East, the Japanese are still getting further advantages from their first treacherous surprise attack.
By far the most important event during this week is the Anglo-Russian Treaty.
I consider I kept our propaganda slightly less disgusting than it might otherwise have been, deodorised it to some small extent. But I felt I was just an orange that was being trodden on by a very dirty boot.
He thought that you could use propaganda machines to invent anything and to make people make speeches they hadn't ever made and so on. And I remember he used to, I think he once tried to do, or toyed with the idea of taking little extracts from Winston's recorded speeches and have him declare peace. You see, in the middle of war, he thought you could have done that.
For 2 years, he was a reluctant mouthpiece for the government. But in 43, Orwell resigned from the BBC.
I had become conscious that I was wasting my own time and the public money on doing work that produced no result. I felt that by going back to my normal work of writing, I could be more useful.
In London, England, with war raging all around them, people need entertainment. But they don't want this. Although it may look like good old-fashioned fun, it's upset a lot of decent folk. The kids playing pigs are leading a revolution against the farmer. It's all based on a new book, Animal Farm. In an exclusive interview, its author, Brit George Orwell, gives us the lowdown on this showdown hoedown.
The actual details of the story didn't come to me for some time, until one day I saw a little boy, perhaps 10 years old, driving a huge cart horse along a narrow path and whipping it every time it tried to turn. It struck me that if only such animals became aware of their strength, we would have no power over them, and that men exploit animals in much the same way that the rich exploit the proletariat.
So it's the Russian Revolution in a barnyard. And Orwell pulls no punches. His pigs betray their own rebellion and start to rule like the human they overthrew. What he's trying to tell us is that the Russian communists can't be trusted, just when we've learned to get along with them. Only recently, the leaders of Britain, America, and Russia enjoyed a friendly supper party. They agreed on a grand design for smashing Germany and signed a lofty declaration ensuring a post-war world free from tyranny.
Orwell thought that people were much too much conned by the Soviet war effort into taking a favorable view of the government of the Soviet Union. This was, of course, the reason for writing Animal Farm at that time.
The kids love Animal Farm, but their parents won't get to read it. The book's not banned, but this is a story nobody wants to hear.
One publisher decided to consult the Ministry of Information, who appear to have warned him, or at least strongly advised him, against publishing it. He wrote, "The fable does follow so completely the progress of the Russian Soviets and their two dictators that it can only apply to Russia. It would be less offensive if the predominant caste in the fable were not pigs. I think the choice of pigs as the ruling caste will no doubt give offense to many people, and particularly to anyone who is a bit touchy, as undoubtedly the Russians are."
Orwell says he won't keep quiet, even if the rest of his country wants him to.
Circus dogs jump when the trainer cracks his whip. But the really well-trained dog is the one that turns his somersault when there is no whip. And that is the state we have reached in this country, thanks to 300 years of living together without a civil war.
Animal Farm was the first book in which I tried, with full consciousness of what I was doing, to fuse political purpose and artistic purpose into one whole.
Some say politics has no place in art.
The opinion that art should have nothing to do with politics is itself a political attitude. What I most wanted was to turn political writing into an art.
Animal Farm was the first product of this approach, but before it was even published, you were considering 1984, were you not?
I thought of it in 1944.
In 1984, true love between individuals is impossible. Only hate is allowed. The only permissible love for power. This bleak future you seem to be forecasting for Britain. Could totalitarianism really happen in a democracy like ours?
I do not think that the kind of society I describe will arrive, but that something resembling it could arrive, and that totalitarianism, if not fought against, could triumph anywhere.
Before the swallow, before the daffodil, and not much later than the snowdrop, the common toad salutes the coming of spring after his own fashion, which is to emerge from the hole in the ground where he's lain buried since the previous autumn and crawl towards the nearest suitable patch of water. At this point, after his long fast, the toad has a very spiritual look, like a strict Anglo-Catholic towards the end of Lent. His movements are languid but purposeful. His body is shrunken, and by contrast, his eyes look abnormally large. A toad has about the most beautiful eye of any living creature,
'tis like gold.
Is it wicked to take pleasure in the spring and other seasonal changes?
If it is only a brighter blue between the chimney pots, or the vivid green of an elder sprouting on a blitzed site.
People, so the thinking runs, ought to be discontented, and it is our job to try and multiply our wants, rather than to increase the enjoyment of the things we already have. And yet, if we kill all pleasure in the actual process of life, what sort of a future are we preparing for ourselves? If a man cannot enjoy the return of spring, why should he be happy in a labour-saving utopia? I think that by retaining one's childhood love of such things as trees, fishes, butterflies, and, to return to my first instance, toads, one makes a peaceful and decent future a little more probable.
In June 1944, we adopted a little boy aged 3 weeks. His names are Richard Horatio.
She was a bit uneasy for fear she couldn't love it enough. She was afraid, see, as it wasn't her own, she might not be able to give it everything it ought to have. But then it was there, 3 weeks old, in the hospital, and they were wanting it. And she went and took it home. And they were both delighted with him.
However, within months of establishing his happy family, Daddy was off again.
At the beginning of 1945, I went to France and then spent some time in Germany, just before the surrender.
There are still 100,000 Germans living among the ruins of Cologne. The whole central part of the city is simply a chaos of jagged walls, overturned trams, shattered statues, and enormous piles of rubble. It is queer to think that these are the people who once ruled Europe from the Channel to the Caspian Sea and might have conquered our own island if they'd known how weak we were.
While Orwell was in Germany, back home Eileen went into hospital for an operation to remove tumours from her womb. She wrote to Orwell from her hospital bed.
Dearest, I'm just going to have the operation, already injected with morphia. This is a nice room. Can see the garden. Not much in it except daffodils, but a nice little lawn. My bed isn't next the window, but it faces the right way. I also see the fire clock.
There the letter ended. Eileen died as a result of the anaesthetic.
Eileen died very suddenly. It was terribly sad that she should die when she had become so devoted to Richard and was making such a good job of his upbringing, and things were just beginning to get better. I felt so upset at home that I thought I would rather be on the move for a bit and do some more reporting.
Immediately after the funeral, Orwell put his son in the care of a nurse and returned to the war. He began working at a furious pace, averaging an article or review every other day. In Europe, ended only 6 weeks after Eileen died. Orwell's celebration was muted, but his gloom was more than grief. To defeat fascism, people had learned to live with less freedom. He thought this left them vulnerable to other types of tyranny.
To be corrupted by totalitarianism, one does not have to live in a totalitarian country. The mere prevalence of certain ideas can spread a poison. And if thought corrupts language, language can also corrupt thought. Defenseless villages are bombarded from the air, the inhabitants driven out into the countryside. This is called pacification. When one watches some tired hack on the platform, mechanically repeating the familiar phrases, bloodstained tyranny, free peoples of the world, stand shoulder to shoulder, one often has a curious feeling that one is watching some kind of dummy. The appropriate noises are coming out of his larynx, but his brain is not involved. This reduced state of consciousness, if not indispensable, is at any rate favourable to political conformity. Maybe I am pessimistic, but at the same time there is not too much cause for optimism in the world today.
This strange, gentle, critical, cynical personality comes out completely in the way he writes as in the way he talks. And this pessimism of his, I think, is peculiar to him. And I'd like to say that this I noticed always in him as a boy, too. It's a bracing pessimism, a feeling that once you admit the worst, everything's a bit more fun all round. And therefore, you almost seek out the worst.
In 1945, Animal Farm was finally published. On the brink of the Cold War, Orwell's anti-Soviet parable became a critical triumph and a bestseller. His success was a pleasant surprise, but it had come too late. His TB lesion had begun to bleed. Having met her on the stairs to his London flat, he wrote to his young neighbour, Anne Popham. There is no knowing how long I shall live, but what I'm really asking you is, would you like to be the widow of a literary man? If things remain as they are, there is a certain amount of fun in this, as you would probably get royalties coming in, and you might find it interesting to edit unpublished stuff, etc. Of course, it's absurd a person like me wanting to make advances to someone of your age. It's just that I feel desperately alone sometimes. Anne Popham turned him down, as did Celia Paget, and Cyril Connolly's assistant, Sonia Brownell, though she remained in touch, even when Orwell, accompanied by a housekeeper and his young son, quit London altogether.
After travelling from London to Glasgow, we took a train, a boat, a bus, and then another boat to arrive here on the Hebridean island of Jura, before travelling the final 7 miles in a car to this remote farmhouse. Our host requested that we bring tea, flour and jam, stout boots and warm clothing. It is in this almost monastic seclusion that the author George Orwell has decided to write his new novel, the first since Animal Farm several years ago. Mr. Orwell, what can you tell us about the new book?
I do not like talking about books before they're written, but I will say that it is a novel about the future. It is, in a sense, a fantasy.
15 miles from the nearest telephone, on an island with just one proper road and one doctor, Mr. Orwell's new home seems inappropriate for a virtual invalid with a young son. But isolation is what Mr. Orwell craves.
One just seems to have such a limited capacity for work nowadays. One has to husband it. These islands are largely uninhabited, so I can work quietly here. I'm getting on with my novel and hope to finish it in the spring. I've not got as far as I'd hoped because I've been in wretched health. My chest, as usual. Of course, I can't see Richard till I'm non-infectious.
The novel Orwell went to the Isle of Jura to write was 1984. For this final attack on totalitarianism, he drew on his entire life.
It is Christmas Eve, 1947. I am again with George Orwell, who, despite severe tuberculosis, has just finished the first draft of 1984 and is being driven to a Glasgow hospital to recuperate.
One wants to live, of course. Indeed, one only stays alive by virtue of the fear of death. But I think now it is better to die violently and not too old. People talk about the horror of war, but what weapon has man invented that even approaches in cruelty some of the commoner diseases? Natural death, almost by definition, is something slow, smelly, and painful.
Of course, I don't know you very well, but it seems to me that this latest illness has changed you. Do you agree?
Yes, isn't it awful? I've got some more false teeth and a little grey in my hair.
Actually, I wasn't referring to physical changes. I was talking more about your attitude towards your book. Have you
a long illness, when one is weak and without appetite, but without being actually feverish or in pain, one gets the impression one's brain is quite normal, one's thoughts just as active as ever. It's only when one attempts to write that you realize the deterioration that has happened inside your skull. Your thoughts, when you have them, are just like your thoughts at any other time. But as soon as they're reduced to some kind of order, they turn into badly expressed platitudes.
In which case, why carry on?
Such a good idea. Couldn't possibly abandon it.
Returning to Jura in the spring of 1948, almost a year after my first visit, I find Mr. Orwell back from hospital and working on the final draft of 1984.
I am just on the grisly job of typing out my novel. It is a very awkward thing to do in bed where I still have to spend half the time.
As ever, when working hard, George Orwell is smoking very heavily. I begin to feel that his book is killing him.
Days after typing up the final draft of 1984, Orwell collapsed again. He was rushed first to a hospital in southern England, then up to London.
We are at University College Hospital in London, at the bedside of Mr. Orwell, whose satirical novel 1984 has been such a publishing sensation. Here is the blue-eyed 30-year-old Miss Sonia Brownell. She has known Mr. Orwell for 5 years and has today, thanks to a bedside wedding, become his wife. The newlyweds hope that Mr. Orwell will soon be well enough to leave hospital so they can go abroad.
There would be no honeymoon. By the time Orwell married Sonia Brownell, 1984 was written, after which he would never leave his bed again. But he left one final warning.
1984 is, I believe, a quite terrifying masterpiece. So terrifying, in fact, I don't think I should like to read another like it.
I am not absolutely dissatisfied with it. I think it is a good idea, but the execution would have been better if I had not been under the influence of TB when I wrote it.
You once claimed that you have an ability to face unpleasant facts. Is that what you've demonstrated in 1984 by drawing an accurate portrait of the future?
I think that allowing for the book being, after all, a parody, something like 1984 could actually happen. This is the direction the world is going in at the present time. In our world, there will be no emotions except fear, rage, triumph, and self-abasement. The sex instinct will be eradicated. We shall abolish the orgasm. There will be no loyalty except loyalty to the party. But always, there will be the intoxication of power. Always, at every moment, there will be the thrill of victory, the sensation of trampling on an enemy who is helpless. If you want a picture of the future, imagine a boot stamping on a human face forever. The moral to be drawn from this dangerous nightmare situation is a simple one. Don't let it happen. It depends on you.
Coming up, Chris Langham in another writer role as BBC Four explores the science behind the fiction of John Wyndham, author of Day of the Triffids and The Midwich Cuckoos. That's next.